to try to suggest six things that I think are going to happen in the near term. And probably in this room, I won't have to persuade you, though I would be happy to persuade you in the Q&A that these things are going to happen. And then I'm going to suggest what it means for us as people who are involved in the new media. As we go, I'm going to suggest, as a result, if you think this is true, here's a practical thing you should do as a result. So I'd like to begin by suggesting that the internet explosion in Christian colleges almost entirely equaled pornography. So if you went to a chapel on internet use at a Christian college, you can be sure that the word pornography would come out of somebody's mouth within the first two paragraphs. Now, despite the fact that someone like George Gilder could point out that as a percentage, there was more pornography in Uncle Bob's drugstore than there was pornography on the internet, still the easy availability of what had been difficult to get at first overwhelmed our cultural ability to deal with it. As I suggested to Christian web conferences ago, every revolution goes through a series of phases. And in the early phase of any revolution, both in technology and in culture, you have the Wild West phase, where the transgressive people get all the attention before the school marms and pastors move in to kind of bring civilization. Now, plainly what happened as we move towards Facebook ethics is the opposite. I'm going to suggest a really contentious thing, and I'll actually pause to take questions. I believe where we're headed ethically on the net is the opposite direction from what people think. That the greatest fear of the new media will be a puritanical phase of American culture, not, as I might prefer, a libertarian phase. It's an odd thing to talk about the day Atlas Shrugged the movie comes out. Maybe the worst novel I've ever read that was supposed to be good, by the way. It's a great book. If you can read Atlas Shrugged without laughing out loud, you're a better person than I am. If you think Christian novels are bad, try reading someone who thinks a 50-page sermon in the middle of a novel is an appropriate thing to do to keep people's attention. It's just unbelievable. And if you can imagine your grandmother talking about her sex life, that's what the sex scenes are in Atlas Shrugged. That was all for free because it's Atlas Shrugged weekend and I'm working out my rage. Why Christians give Rand a pass is beyond me. As closest I ever came to being a socialist was reading Rand, which means not very close of all. I have a picture of the Last Tsar of Russia over my desk, after all. My non-Bolshevik credentials are safe. Here's the point. I think we face more probability of tyranny than the kind of freewheeling libertarian world we imagined would occur. And I'll make a simple argument for why I think that's true. Privacy in a new media world is hard to come up with. And I believe that the multiplication of Facebook, or whatever replaces Facebook, if Facebook becomes replaceable, though perhaps it's reached a critical mass where it's not replaceable. When over half of adults in the United States end up on Facebook, moving platforms now may be impossible. It may not be worth the effort. So I'm going to talk as if Facebook's going to survive, though of course it doesn't really matter to my point if it does. Now in the early days of Facebook, it was hookup culture, right? Hey, pictures of me partying, a little bit sketchy, look at what a good time I can have. And then everybody's parents moved on to Facebook. Now, I know the strategy. I have a normal Facebook profile, and then I have a private profile for my family so that, you know, everything I write about on my personal life doesn't show up on my John Mark N. Reynolds Facebook feed line. Most of you don't care, you know, what I'm doing for birthdays and things like that, and I like to keep some of my life private. But we all know that if my parents, who are also online in their early 70s, wanted to find out that, my other thing, they could just track that down through the friends that are on it. In other words, simply knowing your friends means that in a social networking environment, privacy is ultimately non-existent. Even if you have a false account where you do your naughty stuff, people will figure it out in the end anyway. I always assume that the president of Biola has better things to do than read my Facebook feed, but that's the only reason he can't know everything I'm doing. I mean, he could want, if he wants to know where I'm located, the old Onion joke that the CIA is closing because Americans now give away the FBI all the information they need. They can arrest terrorists now simply by following their Facebook location feed. There's some truth to that. If you're on spring break, you don't have to put the awful picture of yourself online. You just have to have a drunk friend who does. And students aren't stupid. They know that that's going to follow them like a bat out of hell or the albatross around the Ancient Mariner's neck the rest of their life. And if you think about a young Al Gore who was running for president when he was 10, that personality type hasn't disappeared. People realize they're going to have to deal with their new media presence at 18, 19, 20 years old. So that I think it is more likely that the destruction of privacy will have a chilling effect on people's ability to cut loose a little bit, not bring on libertine sexual morals. In other words, if I love my wife and am having a good time with her, nobody, left or right, is going to be critical of me. That's safe. And that's positive. There's a positive reinforcement from my Christian perspective of new media. But if I'm a young adult who's in a dating environment, it also means that taking any kind of risks with my behavior at all is sketchy. Somebody's going to be offended. Some people might think I'm too puritanical. Some people might think I'm too libertine. I'm trying to manage my new media sensibility. The safe thing is going to be a prude. The safe thing is going to be not to get drunk on the weekend. Now, so far, the parents in the room, which includes myself, are thinking, and there's a downside to this? Yeah, there is a downside to this. We all knew the kid in high school who was so good they gave goodness a bad name. Because they were good simply out of social conformity and not from real virtue. There's something positive about the person who doesn't go on spring break and act as if what happens on spring break stays in spring break. They know it affects their soul. There's something negative about the student who lacks the courage to do what they want to do because they're afraid that their future employer is going to Facebook stalk them and find out what they did in their 20s. And they don't know how he or she will react to it. To give you another, less positive from a Christian perspective, at different points in my life, I had all different opinions on about every conceivable issue. Sometimes not politically correct from a left-wing point of view, sometimes not politically correct from a right-wing point of view. And because I'm a strong-minded person, I opined about those things quite freely. Now, we all know that you should be tolerant of what a 21-year-old writes. A 21-year-old might write things that are ill-tempered, stupid, badly thought out. But especially because things on the net don't come with a time date stamp. It's very difficult to try ideas out intellectually without running the risk that once again, some ill-tempered person, some less tolerant person on either the left or right will disqualify you because of your intellectual development since they can't be sure those aren't currently your views. And the private information they picked up won't be openly usable in a job interview. So my suggestion is that the first problem we face is the rise of what I will call Facebook ethics, which will be the attempt to be virtuous in public but now public is almost all the time. This will place a premium on the kind of person you can trust not to Twitter or Facebook what you're talking about. In other words, your most intimate friends will be the ones you can get together with in an environment that's absolutely technologically free. My suggestion is, if someone wants to start a business, that an excellent business would be to start a room where you can be sure there's no technology at all. No one can take your picture, there are no cell phones, there's no access to blogging, and there are no recording devices. Do you realize how unlikely it is, as a teacher, that anything you would try out in class isn't repeated? It's an unlikely thing. And so a kind of Facebook chilling effect may fall on intellectual and social development. I think kids ought to be able to make mistakes. And certainly I'm glad I was able to make mistakes from 18 to 22 with some kind of, I don't want to say statute of limitations, but some kind of not heavy adult glance. A little hypocrisy, in other words, is necessary for a culture this side of paradise to raise healthy people. But an intrusive, no privacy zone, which is what we're entering into, bids fair to produce politically correct Puritans. Not Puritans in the good Calvinistic sense, but Puritans who are constantly posturing so that their public profile, which really is their private profile, will always be consistent. The kind of person who's careful what they say when they come out of the movies in case someone knows who they are. So let me pause and see if there are questions about this. I think as Christians or as religious new media types, we need to help develop zones of privacy, including inside of church services, where people can be all but guaranteed that what they say is like the confessional. One nice thing in my particular religious tradition is there's one person I can talk to that I know, under pain of losing his job, can never repeat what I tell him, namely my pastor. I think we need, as private citizens, to develop the same kind of confessional attitude even in some of our parties, our fun times, or we'll choke off our children's ability to grow up safely. I don't want to know what my college-age children do.
Amen.
Because I want them to be able to make the same mistakes I made, though I don't wish on them mistakes. And woe be to he that helps them make mistakes. But I don't want the woe to come from me. In other words, I can know too much about my kids. Let me pause and see. So my suggestion is, we're about to enter into a potentially tyrannical age where social pressure can prevent you from taking tough stands or trying high-risk behaviors that you should try. Yes, ma'am.
How do you see this as different from the role that the community used to play in a smaller community, where everyone knew what was going on with everyone else?
It isn't at all different, and if I had had more time in this talk, I would have unpacked it this way. There was a kind of golden age for urban exploration, where someone could escape the choking confines of Mayberry, where no black people ever appear on camera, to move off to the big city where they can have O. Henry-like anonymous chances to grow. And during a period of time, let's say from 18 to 30, they disappear from the cultural radar. And then somewhere around 30, 31, 32, they enter into their grown-up life and they're ready to go. Now notice, I'm not saying you should sin. Does everyone hear that? No, you shouldn't sin. One nice thing about new media is this. I don't want to disabuse any of you, but Christian colleges have periodically recruited to the right and taught to the left. In other words, we've pretended that we like the values of the people in the pews that were sending us their kids while we worked hard to help them outgrow the values of the people in the pews. This is now impossible. You can know what any professor thinks about anything because even the most obscure academic paper is easily available. Now, what this has meant as Christian academics is that as a philosopher, you used to be able to have a good professional career in places where people might discriminate against Christians while doing apologetic work on the side. And since those two communities never talked to each other, you could do this safely. Now, whether this was a good idea or not, I would suggest it was not a good idea. It was doable. It is now not doable. If I say in front of this group of people that I believe, as I do, that Jesus is Lord and the Bible is without error, and that I'm a young earth creationist, which I happen to be, I know that if I debate Darwinism, even though it isn't relevant that for Quinean reasons I believe in a young earth, I might as well just say it before the debate begins because my opponent will surely know it. I can't play two games. And Christian colleges still are getting away with this a little bit, but as the generation that knows the internet comes to pass, and as the education bubble, which we're about to talk about, goes away, this two-sided game will not be playable. And so some of this is getting rid of this happy moment in world history when you could leave a small town and the kind of stifling communitarian pressure that prevented intellectual growth. Now, what's positive about small town values? If Uncle Bob ran a drugstore and you bought a girly magazine from Uncle Bob, Uncle Bob may be no good from the family's point of view, but he might call your mom. In the new world we live in, everybody's Uncle Bob. They may do something, but they're going to call you on it if you do it, if it's something you say you shouldn't do. Now, we're both going to have to be tolerant of knowing all our pastors' vices in a way that we've never been able to before, but also provide some space for our leaders to have vices, unless you're planning on hiring Jesus or the Blessed Mother as, you know, your ministry staff. And I'll suggest none of you are likely to do that. So, yes, it is small town America. I want you to hear that. Is there a good side to this? Yes. Accountability. There's a bad side to hypocrisy. Hooray for that. I want you to see the bad side of it, because my suggestion is nothing is so awesome that tyrants can't pervert it for tyranny. And on the whole, traditional Christians need to fear tyranny more than they do libertine points of view. Stalin killed 22 million of us. Vegas is a temptation. If I have a choice of living next to the Gulag Archipelago or the Playboy Mansion, I pick the Playboy Mansion. And I'm not going to live next to the New Jerusalem until Jesus returns. So utopianism, that I can live next to neither, is foolish. I fear tyranny more than I fear some college student cutting loose from 18 to 22 and then being sorry. Maybe it was because I cut loose from 18 to 22 and I'm sorry. Yes, sir.
Do you think the ubiquity of information is going to decrease the effect that the perceived negative things have?
No, it will increase it, because what will happen is something like this. Culture turns on people, and I'll use an example like Michael Jackson. First, Michael Jackson is popular, and so he gets away with things that people wouldn't get away with normally. Then he gets into his 40s, and he stops being able to get away with it because for some reason people decide not to let him get away with it anymore. Then he dies, and he's suddenly back on the wall at Disneyland. Just like Elvis, the Elvis estate must be thrilled that he's dead because he can no longer mess up their marketing. by being a real human being. Now, my suggestion is, Matt, what will happen is something like this. Sure, nothing's going to happen to you until somebody decides something should happen to you. And then we're going to have new rules that say, come on, we all knew Matt wasn't perfect. So what's the point of dragging out Matt's entire life history? But those rules don't exist yet. And what I'm telling you is, communities behave in foolish ways. Look up Friday, Friday, the song. Right? Poor Rebecca Black. No, really, right? Poor Rebecca Black was one of those kids who had fairly well-off parents who think their daughter is more talented than she is. And who thought, the internet is a tool that made Justin Bieber famous. Our super talented daughter will also be famous. Let's spend some money and help her. Don't go read the comment thread following this hapless 13-year-old girl's video. Come on, folks. When the culture decides to turn on you, they do. Now, this 13-year-old girl has already lived through the counter reaction. Oh, she's not that bad. Let's be sympathetic. And now the whiplash of, yeah, she really is that bad, stop defending her, and she's still 13. In other words, if you fall in the cultural crosshairs, she said, what, her video was a few thousand people looked at it, and then the next day she got up and 70,000 people had looked at it. Now, how many kids have produced dumb-looking musical videos in the last 10 years? But that poor girl somehow lucked out and became a clown. Now, maybe she'll get rich out of it. I hope so. But I'm not sure that compensates. I wouldn't want my kid to be Rebecca Black. And yet, in some ways, it was her parents' virtues that got her in trouble, not their vices. They believed in their daughter. And they didn't have taste. But whose parents did? I mean, come on, folks. And you can't expect a 13-year-old to know she's making a fool of herself. And maybe you can blame the people who took the parents' money. But I don't know. What I'm telling you is, that makes me, if I'm a 13-year-old, want to do what? Not stand on stage and sing. Because somebody's going to take their phone and film me, and then even if it's only 100 kids, they're going to tell me how fat I am. So, as a person who struggles with being depressed, I can only tell you that getting emails once a week telling me how ugly I am from photos on the net by people who disagree with my politics is wearing, even at 47. So what does it tempt you to do? Pull back. I don't say controversial things, because if I say controversial things, I have to live with whatever feedback there is. And the feedback will be immediate, and it will be straightforward, and it will be super opinionated. And is there anything we can do about this? No, you're nice, but lots of people aren't. And it will have a chilling effect on risk-taking, Matt, in areas like the arts. I'm not going to go out for theater and be a 14-year-old kid doing Shakespeare badly and have that film that some sap will put on YouTube follow me around and have my colleagues laughing at me in the corporate boardroom in my 40s.
But don't you just think that maybe, I totally get what you're saying, I think you're probably right, but I would maybe say in response, maybe there's just gonna be so much bad stuff out there
that's your only hope.
Through, I mean, I feel this way about my blogging archives, right?
Yeah.
You can go back and read my archives, and I'm sure find asinine things that I have said.
Yesterday. Yeah, that was really well played. Community theater does do some good for you. I'm just saying.
But at the same time, there's so much information out there that
you need an enemy, Matt.
I'm gonna get him.
Right. And so here's the point. Yeah, what you think is there's so much information out there, nobody will use it until somebody does. Mm-hmm. Now, the mature people will say, no, listen, the mature human resource managers will say what? Well, let's just go ask him about it. He wrote this asinine thing. So I went to a job interview once, and I suggested in a blog post from a decade ago that theistic evolutionists should be removed from our social discourse like daisies on the putting green of life. Now, that was a decent throwaway line. Maybe. But I was at a job interview and someone raised their hand. I didn't even remember writing it. And I was in a more intemperate age back in the day where I said things like that. I wouldn't say that now. And they said, am I a daisy on the putting green of your life? Well, first of all, I wasn't talking about people. I was talking about an idea in my head. But it didn't really matter, right? Someone wanted to make me look like an extremist. There was an intemperate extreme thing I said. And so there you go. Was I really thrilled that that came up? No, I wasn't. Now, all the sensible people in the room had a laugh and said, wow, glad I don't write all my opinions online. But that's a problem. Do you hear that? The first reaction of the people in the room was, his mistake was blogging. So I think, Matt, there's going to be a chilling effect on non-puff piece things. No good came to me of saying that I thought Rob Bell wrote a bad book. Right. Do you see, what did I gain from that? Nothing. I don't get paid to blog. Rob Bell has huge numbers of fans. If you agreed with my opinion, you never wrote me an email, right? Because you won't. So what did I, other than, I don't even dislike Rob Bell. I love his glasses. And if I could look once as cool as Rob Bell, it would change my life. The point is, having an opinion about his book did me no good. And I'll tell you this, I found myself, when I was blogging for the Post, skipping all the gay marriage questions. I just quit answering them, because I couldn't take it. I'm just being honest with you. I don't care much about the issue to start with. I have strong but not fervent views. And I just got tired of it. Because all I got was hate. Now, I'm not saying that so you all say nice things to me and hug me. What I'm saying is, if that's true of super opinionated people who are in jobs where they get paid to have strong opinions and are safe, what's going to happen to young adults who realize if I blog and intellectually develop in public, I'm going to face these kinds of questions? What I'm telling you is, in a room where somebody says, am I a daisy in the putting green of life, Matt, is not that people say, well, we all do that, because we don't. Blogging isn't growing. Vlogging isn't growing. It's coming from the kind of intellectual class that we need to develop, particularly in the church. And what people hear when they see some poor sap like me getting blindsided by a blog post they wrote 10 years ago is, glad I don't do it. So what I'm telling you guys as a group of Christian new media personality people is, you've got to fight it. Fight tyranny. Dare to say politically incorrect things and then take them back. Now, I'm not saying be hateful on purpose. I'm not saying make mistakes on purpose. But if you are involved in new media, a lot of what you say will be stupid. So my problem with Rob Bell isn't that he said something that I think is sub-Christian. It is, if we push back, will he say, oh, well, some of what I said was wrong or fuzzy? No, the temptation in a new media world is to do what? You can't move back because you'll pay the whole price for having said a heterodox thing and get no benefit for a retraction, except to be called a waffler, which in the new media world or the political world has turned into the worst accusation you can make. God help the person who was pro-choice and becomes pro-life, or who was for traditional marriage and becomes against it. Way to fall between two stools. Because people who dislike your earlier position will go on being mad at you, and the people who don't like your new position now don't trust you. It's a tough world to grow intellectually in. And what I'm saying is, tough luck. If we're gonna deal with tyranny, we're all gonna have to take this risk, Matt, but don't expect not to pay a price for it. It's the Facebook chilling effect, yes.
But isn't it a better world for the reason that you now, as an intellectual, have to own your ideas
yeah.
in a way that you might not have to before?
Here's the good news. I'm skipping over all the positives in this room. Does everyone see that? Like, what's the good news? Well, it used to be that if you were a Biola professor, you might talk to 400 people in a given week. Now, if you have something worth saying, 4,000 people might hear what you have to say in a given week or more. The second thing I wanted to say is that there is almost a sure end to tuition-driven academic institutions within the next decade, and geographically based education. Let me pair that, since that's been argued for by other people both at this conference and the media conference that just finished in parallel at Biola. Let me not argue for that until we get to questions, and simply say that this will partly be the result of the death of credentialism and the rise of personal brands. I am now going to describe this in negative terms, but obviously I think whether it's negative or not, it's going to happen, and that there's a positive side to it. The rise of the Trump campaign for president, which I think you underestimate at your peril, if he in fact has money, and you never know if Trump actually has money. He's one of those people famous for being rich while frequently not being rich. Not unlike most Christian academics who are famous for being academic without being academic or Christian. But the rise of personal brands means that having a personal brand is more important than your actual credentials for the job you hold. As people come to dislike or distrust credentials more and more. Now, in the area of medical knowledge, scientific knowledge, theology, and philosophy, we can all see the great dangers of this. The upside, of course, is any tyranny of the credential, accreditation agencies, for example. I have a PhD, so I get to write about Plato. Matt doesn't have a PhD, so he doesn't get to write about Plato, is over. And on the whole, I view this as a good thing, though the difficulty, as the movie and film industry is discovering, is who will pay for education. Since both aristocracy and democracy have virtues, who will pay for the virtues of the aristocracy? The virtues of the democracy will triumph. That is, people will be able to choose the brand they want and the message they want to hear. If you don't believe that this is a problem, Matt and I were talking before the break, Matt Anderson and I, and there's a belief among some people that Christian academics exercise disproportionate power, seminaries, in the Christian community. We know this is false because of big percentage of the people who would read my work fall into the ludicrous notion of birtherism. That is, the belief that it is an interesting and relevant question to discuss whether Barack Obama was born in the United States. And no matter how much National Review writes about it, no matter how implausible it is that the Hillary Clinton campaign for president would have had damaging evidence on Barack Obama and refused to use it out of the graciousness of the Clintons to their political opponents. Because people with credentials are widely distrusted or buried by people with strong personal brands who tell people what they want to hear, amongst the very constituency that I otherwise like, I have no particular ability to end birtherism any more than an 18-year-old student blogging attacking birtherism has, and maybe less, since I'm part of the establishment that supposedly has something to lose if I question Barack Obama's citizenship. Now, I will only say, as a young earth creationist, that if I were afraid to stake out difficult and career-ending positions, refusing to be a birther while being a young earth creationist strikes me as a ludicrous choice set. In other words, to be a Christian in the academy of any sort is not exactly a positive career move. But my point is this: we are so much at the end of credentialism that credentialed conservatives of the truest tinge cannot end an insane belief amongst their own community, even more than trutherism, the belief that the 9/11 attacks were a conspiracy by the Bush administration and the nation of Israel, could be ended by sensible academic voices on the left. However embarrassing the beliefs became in their own constituency. Now that's the negative side of it, but I assume in this room we already know the positive side. But for universities or high schools to continue as if giving out credentials will within the next decade keep them in business is to live in a fantastic world in which people who love horses will choose to own a horse over driving a car. I love horses. Hooray for horses. I have no clue how to ride one because it doesn't fit in a modern lifestyle. In the same way, the fact is that most people could get an effective education spending almost no money. What they would lack is a shiny credential. I'll bet on the future. Now, what this will lead to is the rise in a premium experience. By which I mean this: sitting in a room with a good professor like Fred Sanders or Melissa Schubert at the Torrey Honors Institute is not the same as Skyping. Because we are incarnate beings, we have bodies, it matters that you're there. I've seen the David by video, and I've stood in front of it. And I'll tell you this, you have to be there. I've done class online. In fact, I taught a philosophy class online on a Commodore 64 on what was called QLink, an intro to philosophy class where questions came to me so slowly. I wanted free QLink, and so I proposed teaching an intro to philosophy class in the cafe. If that wasn't one of the first public philosophy classes to be done online, I bet it was close in a broad non-university network. I could read, I had to guess the questions about midway through to start typing my answers because the modem, which was 300 baud, was so slow. And sometimes I'd guess badly and you'd give an answer like Abraham Lincoln to a totally unrelated question. It was bizarre. What it means is there'll be a premium on incarnate experiences. What will colleges be able to charge for being there? The rite of passage sense that is all that a lot of people get out of college anyway, as they sense credentialing. But this will take place in geographic regions scattered across the country. After all, most people don't play football at USC. They need a dorm and adult transition program that makes them money instead of costing them money. And some institution with credentials will seize the day here. The first couple of people to try it will be Napstered by the credentialing agencies, and the next couple of people to try it will put the rest of us out of business. There will exist, in my opinion, less a Wild West phase in new media and a conglomeration of new media power in a few major players, as quality drives out low quality merchandise. In other words, Amazon can now, with Apple and Google, provide such a seamless shopping and other experience that it's becoming more and more difficult for mom and pop websites to compete without being sucked into the board. The same will occur in Christian new media as a few conglomerates, some of which may not even exist today, begin to drive out poor quality in terms of appearance work with shinier quality work. After all, the fact that you could surf the entire web doesn't mean you do. And if the behavior of most of my students is any indication, if 10 or 11 websites went down, most of their browser activity would cease. In short, the fact that you can go anywhere on the web doesn't mean you do. And particularly in an iPad or closed world, it will be more and more tempting to run everything through Apple, run everything through Google, run everything through players that may be, in fact, hostile to traditional religious values. What is my suggestion? It's time for Christians to become the equivalent of the brown coats on Firefly or Serenity. We need to exercise a confederacy, not that confederacy. I'll tell you this, if you're a Reynolds, you have nothing good to say about that confederacy. When the state of Virginia seceded from the Union, the Reynolds family seceded from Virginia. And if you Texans think you have a right to secede, I'll just remind you that West Virginians had to beat you up 150 years ago and were perfectly capable of doing it again. So I don't mean that confederacy, which was evil. I mean a confederacy, a loosely associated group of churches and Christian organizations that will not tyrannically demand conformity from the people involved, but will allow for a range of opinions, both political, theological, and otherwise. In short, if we are going to fight against multi-billion dollar corporations, we're going to have to know who our allies are. We can make alliances with Mormons in Utah without expressing agreement for everything they believe theologically if they'll join the Brown Coat Rebellion against uniformity. If they attempt to oppose uniformity themselves, then we must rebel against that. In short, the Christian new media presence must be inherently subversive, the way Jesus was inherently subversive to the Roman and Jewish political and religious establishments. I have, on good authority, that God was neither a Republican or a Democrat, being a monarchist at heart. And so Christians can never become captive to one political party, or to one economic system, or to one cult of personality. Yet simultaneously, the belief that one should not stake out turf in the city of man while we are here, that one can somehow be non-committal on the great issues of our day and still see what it is God is doing, is an absurd notion. We need tolerance for people who are Republican or who are Democrat because they think that's what they should be and what God has called them to be, without facile or farcical attempts at common ground. Our common ground will come in our refusal to bow the knee to the board. But we must tolerate strong opinions that disagree with us. If someone like Rob Bell wants to say that I'm not a good enough lover because I believe in hell, then I should be free to say to Rob Bell, you're not enough of a romantic to believe in hell. Because you've created a god like a Las Vegas lounge lizard that follows us around and will never take no for an answer. But no means no in romance as well as in theology. And yet, in many of the great moral questions of our time, Rob Bell is a brown coat. And so if he can tolerate my criticism, I can tolerate his heterodoxy. Because if I can make common cause with a member of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints to protect traditional marriage, I can make common cause with Rob Bell to end the horror of human trafficking across the face of the planet. The confederacy of those who, because they are followers of King Jesus, refuse to give their ultimate allegiance to any state, party, or platform, should not, as I suggested in my section on Facebook ethics, produce a mushy, oatmeal, beige kind of Christian web presence. But instead, may we raise hell to the ground. May we fight against the principalities and powers of this age with our best weapons. May we fight the abuse of the poor by big business, which killed my grandparents, as heartily as we fight against the abuse of power by the tyrannical nanny state that would strangle liberty in its grave. May we fight the abuse of religion in fundamentalist communities that will not send their daughters to college, and I'm talking about the Christian community, and cease to tolerate that oppression while simultaneously refusing to become intolerant of those who within the liturgy would proclaim that men are still men and women are still women. May we allow for genuine diversity in a confederacy of brown coats who will not bow the knee to any king but King Jesus, who will love God and do whatever they will, even if it costs us in this life, because we live for the life to come. Thank you. To pause after my first suggestion, because that was the most contentious thing I was going to say, which is that we're about to enter into a new prudish period. Now, oddly, I think that's unlikely to be in the area of sexual ethics, but more likely to be in the area of intellectual opinions. I'll also say this. Historically, when the government ceases to regulate the most public behavior people engage in, namely sexuality, it almost always begins to regulate private behavior, namely economics. The most public thing a man or a woman does is have a child. The most private thing they do, in many ways, traditionally, is decide how they're going to spend their money. Since men and women aren't angels, generally Christians have believed you could regulate one or the other, but not both, without tyranny. My suggestion is that we'll regulate more and more people's opinions as we cease to regulate their libertine behavior. Because we won't be able to live in a world where people do whatever they want. We can allow libertine behavior here, but we can't let it go over here, or we'd cease to exist as a culture. And you can basically pick the area you want to regulate. You can pick. I'm not going to tell you which we should do. Yes?
You asked, what is it that the traditional Brigham Young University would have to offer?
Yes.
In this new world? It seems that for hundreds of years, one of the things they had to offer was a place where young people could do stupid things.
Right.
From them, and it wouldn't follow them. I don't think Yale opened their police records to actual civilian police until the 1970s. My question is simply, you know, with that puritanical swing, is that a legitimate thing that A, they have to offer that will cause brick and mortar universities to survive, and B, a solution to the first problem?
Yeah, brick and mortar universities need to forget about classes that are this big and put all their students in classes no bigger than 16 with one full-time professor, where they sell incarnate almost one-to-one experience at a premium, and they give the credential away for free. All the information should be given away and done online in the most efficient way possible. All the experience should be done instantly and discreetly. But here's a good thing. Colleges and universities were abusive systems themselves with power. I do think that having separate campus police from mainstream police was always fraught with peril. And one good thing is not being able anymore to commit crimes, particularly against women, and have them be passed off as boys will be boys. So I think, let me remind you that on the whole, if I'm going to teach at a Christian college, the fact is, I don't live a perfect life, and I hope you'll tolerate that. Right now, people can make a list of all my faults over the course of my whole life. Simultaneously, I'm doing the best I can today. So I think we'll start judging people by the trajectory of their life, if we're sane, and also be providing, this is where I'm agreeing with you, space where grown-ups, I hope like I am, can listen to young adults like you say crazy things and never repeat them. I think teachers are going to have to, in that sense, start viewing themselves like priests in the confessional, where the ultimate sin of a professor would be to blog or use in a discernible way examples that he got from students. In other words, you should be able to come into my office and say, communism, wow, it seems like a good idea to me. And I listen to you, and we talk about it, and I give you some reading, and I never repeat it, even if you run for president, and I don't like you otherwise, because it would be the unpardonable sin for me to reveal that. I should be out of work if I betray you. I think it's good that Barack Obama's master's degree thesis wasn't released, to the best of my knowledge. I don't think there are any copies of it left. But I think, you know, come on, guys. I tried all kinds of ideas out in my dissertation that I don't agree with anymore. Why is it relevant? It might be relevant to his intellectual growth and maturity. Save it for his biography. Find out what he wants to do today. There are some big relevant facts about his life. But this notion that we'll peer too hard at people's private intellectual development is, I think, tyrannical. And it'll be done to a right-wing personality just as much as a left-wing personality. And I think it's wrong. It's not healthy for our culture. Any more than firing every pastor that looked at internet porn would be plausible. Right? The fact that you can know every single naughty thought that somebody had over the course of their life, we're not going to have to lower our standards. We don't have to claim that something is, objectifying women is wrong. Do people do it? Yes. Can you now know more that they do it than you used to be able to? Yes. And so we're going to have to live with those two bits of data without turning into witch hunters. And I'm just telling you right now, the temptation to purge every author at a university that writes a theologically incorrect thing is overwhelming on both the left and the right. On the other hand, because of this fear of purges, if somebody writes something negative, there's a big chilling effect amongst academics to say that they think the person was a clown. So if we're not careful, we'll end up with a few risk takers on the right and the left who become bomb throwers because they have nothing to lose and everything to gain at their big mega churches or with their big mega personalities on something like Fox News. And the same people won't say that Glenn Beck engages in conspiracy theories that are not helpful and not always well argued. Or that David Barton, who is evidently an exemplary Christian, is not an exemplary historian. Because it hurts my team. Now, we can't do this. Now, here's the point. If you love David Barton, what do I hope you do? Right? He is an exemplary historian. And we'll have an argument. Then his browncoats will go out and fight the dehumanizing tyranny of our culture. Another couple of questions. I know we're at 3 and I don't want to go too much over. I know most of you have things to do, people to see. I want to inspire you, though. with this. If you're not going to be brave enough to put it on the line, then who will be? You've been given all this power, Matt Anderson, by technology. You going to use it to get your next job in your 50s today? Because if you pick a favorite presidential candidate, that's dangerous. There's nothing to gain, hardly, and everything to lose. If I endorse, I'll make up a name, Mike Huckabee. Everybody that doesn't like Mike Huckabee will be offended with me, and Mike Huckabee supporters won't care. So what's the temptation in my position? To have no opinion. That's the safe thing. And what I'm telling you is, don't do it. Don't become beige. Raise a little hell. Write in vivid colors. Purge beigeness from your life like a daisy on the putting green of your soul. Two more questions if there are any. I don't want to talk your head off. Yes, ma'am.
I'm someone who has been destroyed by saying things that were very controversial, but it was okay.
Thank you. No, wait, stop. Thank you. I don't even care if I agree with you. Let me suppose for a minute that I disagree with you totally. Hooray.
Thank you.
Okay.
Is there a responsibility of the church and the Christian institution and academic institutions that have a Christian worldview to train the body of Christ to treat each other with love and respect as we have our arguments?
Yes.
And that is not happening as far as I can see.
Yes. Because that itself would be contentious.
Yeah.
So I run into two kinds of people. They get really mad at me because I'm not going to vote for Barack Obama. But mostly when I go to churches, people say, it's really hard to read your blogs because you're so nice to Barack Obama. So I think we have a real problem in our culture making non-personal arguments. This is what I suspect. Now, I don't care. The point is not to be political. Biola has no political views because they're an institution. And the guy downstairs from me, who runs the political science department, did vote for Barack Obama and will vote for him again. So I'm speaking for me. What I'm saying is, in this sense, I don't care about your political views. If we can mix it up the way Ronald Reagan and Tip O'Neill did, and then slap each other on the back and go have a Diet Coke. Unless we're in Utah, in which case we'll have green tea. I start down that road and we'll be drinking nothing but water. And we don't want to drink water because fish die in water. Just saying. Ever see a dead fish in Diet Coke? No. Look, yeah, but that's your fault. It's a denominational thing. I can tolerate anything in the Brown Shirt Rebellion except for the Diet Pepsi people. Because anybody who drank battery acid for fun, what's up with that? Okay. Yes.
What about the virtue of contrition? Like, I've said some stupid things to people online, and then I've apologized and gain credibility for it.
Yeah, you gain credibility with sensible people. The bad news for you is that sensible people are always a small group of people. So I have my good friend, Lindsay Stallings, whose married name I won't use because of where she works, and we don't agree politically. So she's always sending me emails and we go back and forth. And at one point I said a really intemperate thing about the opposite political party. So I had to let, Lindsay write a long piece anonymously because of where she works, refuting me. What did I gain by that? Well, my friends on the right thought I was a weenie, and I have no friends on the left other than Lindsay. So what do you gain? What I'm telling you is you have to decide who you care about. I care about your opinion, Lindsay's opinion. I care about the opinion of the Tory chums. And 20% of those people hate me. So you've got to just say, This is what's so hard. When I was, this is so dumb, I can't believe I believed it. When I was a grad student in philosophy, I thought, oh, philosophy is so awesome. Everyone will become reasonable and will solve our problems. And then I'll get married and we'll have no problems because we'll get a whiteboard and sketch out our problems like a flowchart until we come to the correct solution. And then I discovered that though I married a reasonable woman and though I was a reasonable man, we were both men and women, which meant often dumb. And that logic was good as far as it went, but it didn't go very far. Then I discovered that something like most people hate reason and arguments and wish Socrates would die. It is, after all, the majority that killed Socrates and Jesus and most of the great thinkers of time have not exactly been popular. Now look at us, we're lame thinkers. We can't even comfort ourselves in thinking we're Socrates. And everyone's gonna hate you. I'm sorry.
I respect you.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is, I'm gonna have to care about your opinion, and I do care about your opinion as a blogger, not about, if I read the comments threads at the Washington Post, I quit blogging. It's a depressive personality. I can't take it. I just can't care. Does everyone get that? But I do care because I'm prideful or something, or just depressed, or human. And so you're going to have to pick who you care about. And I'll tell you what. I got my dad and Hope and Fred and Paul and Melissa. You better have a community like that you're accountable to, who can tell you, that was a stupid thing you wrote, like Lindsay told me, who don't agree with you on everything. So a diverse community. So, you know, my gay friends keep me honest on homosexual issues. And if you don't have those people in your life, get them. And those are the people you're gonna have to care about, because everyone else is gonna Rebecca Black you. Because eventually, I once gave a talk. I had the picture of the last Russian Tsar over my bed when I was 12. So I really know Alexandra's name. But I once gave a whole talk where I called her Alexandria for some weird reason. Now, if you want to make me look dumb, try putting together a compilation of every mistake like that I've made. And nobody listened to anything I said. And it wouldn't be hard. Unless you love the person. So, Sarah Palin, should she be president? I don't know right now. Probably not, in my opinion. But I won't attack her personally. Barack Obama, should he be president? Probably not, in my opinion. But I won't attack him personally. I think the church needs to start training people to be charitable. But I'll tell you this, there's something deeply wrong with a Christian subculture that has to teach people to be nice. The Romans said of us, and then I'm done, behold how they love one another. I think our secular friends should often say of us, behold how they move into opposite camps and will tolerate no one who doesn't agree with them on everything in exactly the right way. And yet the answer isn't to be full of mush. In our culture, people who cry for love never bring out justice. And people who cry for justice are so hateful and narrow they can see down a straw with both eyes. The middle way, not gonna make you love friends. Because we're not good enough. I'm not good enough to even be a martyr for righteousness.
I'm just going to have to be a man who loves his wife and kids and his students and did the best he could.
Biola University offers a variety of biblically-centered degree programs, ranging from business to ministry to the arts and sciences. Visit biola.edu to find out how Biola could make a difference in your life.